Ladies and gentlemen, I have retired from service in the year 94. After my retirement, I have established the Railway Pensioners Organization in my area. Now I am devoting my life to pensioners and the peace movement. I would like to make a brief presentation about India's space program. India has made significant progress in space science and technology. It launched its first rocket into space in the year 1963. Near about 40 satellites have been launched before launching the record-breaking 104 satellites in one attempt on February 15, 2017. India professes that its space program is primarily for peaceful uses. The political stand is space to be used for the peaceful purposes. Several prime ministers and presidents expressed that the use of space exploration is for peaceful purposes only. Indian Space Research Organization ISRO established a reputation of reliability of launching smaller satellites using Polar Satellite Launch Vehicle, PSLV. Of late, the stand started undergoing a change. Relationship with important neighboring countries like China and Pakistan are not cordial. India fought two wars with Pakistan in 1965 and 1971, apart from Kargil War. In 1999, and several terrorist attacks, including one on Indian Parliament in December 2001 and in Mumbai in November 2008, on the wars between India and Pakistan, US and UK supported Pakistan. India had a war with China in the year 1962. This situation led the military establishment planning to use space for defense while the political establishment stands for peaceful purposes. Even the political establishment also started changing its stand. The situation has got further worsened when China conducted an anti-satellite test in January 2007. ISRO has launched a dual satellite and also a dedicated satellite for the Navy. GS-87. A range of defense application satellites are being planned. Defense Research and Development Organization, DRDO, has announced that it can harness the technology for manufacturing anti-satellite weaponry. Global instability and the worsening situation in South Asian region is leading to establish Aerospace Command. It is being felt that a well-equipped aerospace command could go a long way towards helping India to meet its emerging strategic challenges and security threat in a very effective manner. According to retired Air Marshal Kapil Kirk, quote, early establishment of aerospace command often offers enormous prospects to leverage space complement comprehensive national development and serve as a space sword and space shield for conventional and nuclear deterrence. Military satellite based assets for space situational awareness, communication, surveillance and imagery, navigation and precision targeting, inclusive of ballistic and cruise missiles, and missile warning for ballistic missile defense serve as a game changer in military force application. Space command models for major powers could be gainfully configured to evolve a command and control architecture situated to Indian needs. Quote, unquote. Mr. Amit R. Saxena, a postgraduate scholar, states that an opponent of the weaponizing of space, India has made impressive development with its Agni 5th intercontinental ballistic missile, joining an elite club of countries that possesses this technology. Recently, the Defense Research and Development Organization announced that it can harness the technology to manufacture anti-satellite weaponry. This, along with the Indian Space Research Organization's success with indigenous launch vehicles, equipped the Indian space program with technological capability to undertake space weaponization's activities, unquote. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, former President of India, suggested that a program of space security, World Space Vision, World Space Council. Its purposes are, one, protection of space comprehensively is a common interest of mankind. Two, all the space-faring nations have to come together and bring down the cost of access to space. Number three, a world space vision should enhance the quality of human life, inspire the spirit of space exploration, expand the horizons of knowledge, and ensure space security for all nations of the world. Four, it is also essential to create a World Space Council, which could oversee the planning and implementation of large-scale and societal missions like energy from space, space security, and deep space exploration. Five, formation of international space force for regulating and preventing any unauthorized weapon or weapon-related system activity in space. Six, political leadership of space-faring nations has to come together and adopt a world space vision. So long the US government sticks to vision for 2020, it is very difficult to expect other countries not to opt for militarization of space. The problem and the solution lies with the government, with the US government. With this situation in India, an international conference coinciding with the Global Network Organizational Conference has been held at Visakhapatnam in India on 18th to 20th November in association with the Law School of Getham University and Center for Cultural, Educational, Economic and Social Studies, Nagpur. Students and youth have been targeted to participate and be paid rich dividends. Students from different law schools and young professors have dominated the discussions. This is the first time for them to talk and discuss on the issues related with the militarization and weaponization of space. Mr. Bruce Gagnon, Coordinator, Global Network, Professor Devgav, Campaign for Nuclear Disarmament, UK, Mr. Yasuo Ogata, Gensukyo, Japan, Mr. William Griffin, Veterans for Peace, USA, Ms. Sanghi, anti-naval base activist from Jeju Island, also participated. The issues which have been enlightened by the speakers are space technology and protection of environment, future challenges of space loss, role of UNO, the impact of space technology in developing countries, the development of missile defense in Europe, global military bases, Japan and nuclear disarmament, space debris, legal issues and remedies, role of youth in space making, sustainable space utilization and international cooperation in space to prevent confrontation, space warfare, etc. The conference has been inaugurated by Professor Dr. R. Venkatrao, Vice Chancellor, National Law School of India University, Bangalore, and the valedictory function was chaired by Justice G. Bhavani Prasad. The address contains scholarly ideas on various issues connected with the space with a sense of activism. Professor Y. Satyanarayana, Director of Getham Law School, who masterminded the arrangements for the conference, declared that the issues connected with the space for peace and will be intertwined in the academic activity of the law school. And this conference has helped us in extending the influence and the work of global networks in various universities and also in various districts of India. This R. Venkatrao, who is the Vice Chancellor of the Law School, National Law School, Bangalore. When I requested him, sir, at least one such event in every year should be organized in your law university. He replied, yes, it can be done with your cooperation. That is one benefit from this conference. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, India is thinking itself as an emerging superpower. And it is being abetted by US imperialism. And USA is now trying to attract the economic development of India into its game of things. And Obama always praises our Prime Minister Modi. Modi always praises Obama. That was taking place till yesterday. Now, a new governor, a new president has come in USA. I don't think the attitude of India is going to change. It is present government is a Hindu fundamentalist government. It is not the left of government just like the previous Congress government. It is completely right and pro-Israel and pro-imperialism. Therefore, in the years to come, I apprehend the situation is going to be a little bit difficult because India is going to tilt towards US imperialism. Thank you for your listening. Thank you.
You know, we can just move this. Oh, there's a light, I see. This is a light. No, she wants the light.
Yeah, I need a bit of light.
Okay, well, our next panelist, and at the end, we have two more panelists, and we'll have some time for questions and discussion, is Linda Percy. And she's from the north of England. She's the co-founder of the Campaign for Accountability of American Bases. She founded that in 1992. She stepped down from coordinating CAB last year, but has continued her activism and advocacy, for which she has, which included over 500 arrests that she has had in her versus Linda's.
When you ask questions of the military and those in authority, you bump into trouble. I was shocked when I came through Huntsville Airport yesterday. I wasn't expecting that barrage of military obscenities as I came through. I really was shocked. But then we come here in this beautiful place and I feel very safe and it's lovely to be with everybody. I come from Yorkshire, as Joe said, which is in the north of England. Well, I'm English, as you could hear. I'm really wanting to say that I'm a European. And I'm deeply, deeply upset as to what's going on. What a waste of money, and it's another version of Cloud Cuckoo Land. Mrs. May, well, you've got Trump, and we've got Brexit, and it's not very good. And Mrs. May was quite obscene, I'll use that word again, in her hurried visit to meet Trump. And they held hands, and we were all horrified. Many of us were horrified by that. And he's evidently coming to England on a state visit. And we will give him a welcome. I'm asked to talk about a base in the north of England called Menwith Hill. I don't know if people have heard of it. It's the largest intelligence gathering and surveillance base outside America. It's extremely significant and strategically important. I live about 8 miles from this base. And it's in the most beautiful part of England. American bases are always in really lovely places. Of course, you know, there's curlews singing, wonderful, evocative sound of the curlews. And then there's this awful base. I'll tell you a little bit about it. It's called all American bases in England. There aren't any American bases in Scotland, Wales, or Northern Ireland, just in England. And they came after the Second World War, and we just gave them. There was no legal protection, or no credible legal protection built in to take control or have some sort of accountability. They're all called RAF, Royal Air Force Menwith Hill, Royal Air Force Lakenheath, Royal Air Force Mildenhall. All these bases are publicly called RAF, and it is that was deliberate. We have some very interesting historical documents that were disclosed in a High Court case that I was involved with. I'll say a little bit about it. I have a great interest in using the law to effect change. and we have been quite successful, really appeared at all levels of the English legal system, apart from the Supreme Court and the House of Lords, but civil law and criminal law, and have made authorities in the High Court that have been used by other peace campaigners, which is really good, and other people. They're not RAF, it's a US-based, Menwith Hill is run by the National Reconnaissance Office. I was pleased to hear Dave mention all these systems, because it is very important that we know about that. And it's run by the National Security Agency. As I said, it's the largest intelligence and surveillance base outside America. And there are 25 radomes. You know what a radome is. They look like big golf balls, satellite dishes covered up like huge golf balls or an outbreak of mushrooms or something. But they are lethal. What goes on inside is lethal. Did I say there were 10 bases in England? That is tiny. I'm just amazed at what you have to deal with here. I mean, just coming to Huntsville and being aware of what the extent of the military is here is shocking to me. It really is. And I take my hat off to the peace group here, who, and around all these people, all you people here, and the local peace group who are going. I can't remember your name, local person. Yes.
Leanne,
who I met
David,
this morning.
David, from the UK, but he's lived here 20 years.
Good, that's great. But that it's really hard, and you keep going. So I'm going to concentrate on Menwith Hill. I was asked just to let you know what they do, which is about intelligence gathering, but I'm going to concentrate on two roles. There are more than two roles for this space. And I'm going to call it CAB, Campaign for the Accountability of American Bases. Work in very many ways. Yes, we put on demonstrations, and that's really important, I think it's an absolute place to witness and have a vigil at this place and say to the people inside the base coming out that tonight there are a few people here who oppose what you're doing. Even if there's one person there, it's really important that happens. And I'll tell you about the Tuesday night demonstration that we've run since 2000, later on. Annie Rainbow and I founded CAB in 1992, as I say, and we built up how we were going to work, which was, yes, demonstrations, as I say, but also quiet work, and I think that's the important work that we do, actually, which is actually things like working with members of Parliament. We work with an MP who asks questions for us, and send, it is her now, just a new MP we're working with, send her suggested questions to ask the Secretary of State for Defence why the base is here. No, it wouldn't be so good, it's so naive to say that, but put out a question for this person to ask, and that makes it really easier. Some questions aren't answered, of course, and others, when the answer comes back, there's usually another question in the answer. So you go on just chipping away and trying to get some accountability for the presence of the US visiting forces and their agencies in England. As I say, I stepped down from CAB, as you said, at the end of last year, but I'm doing sort of freelance work now and doing that sort of work, but also the court work. And we have a great struggle going on at Menwith Hill about the right to peaceful protest. I think that we have to be so vigilant about these civil liberties that have been struggled for centuries, actually. I think of the Quakers in England who, in the 17th century, you know, were thrown into rat holes. There was no sort of method of accountability in prison. There is now. Doesn't always happen, mind you, but there is now. And, you know, they were just, nobody knew they'd gone, but they stood up for their beliefs. and the right to peaceful protest was gained. But we're having great difficulties with that at Menno's Hill now. There is a demonstration every Tuesday evening, and it's only been going since 2000. Every single week, except for about five times, winter, spring, summer, and autumn. We're just emerging out of winter, and it's absolutely glorious to be there in the light. And so, I have been very interested in the law and using it to effect change, and challenged all the laws that they've used at Menwith Hill. I have five injunctions around American bases, permanent injunctions. Their security, I have to say, is terrible. I mean, you know, it's worryingly bad in England. But at Menwith Hill last year, they tried another law that, as soon as they said about it, they used it suddenly, I spotted a flaw and said, refused to do what they asked me to do, in which is leave, and so it comes to court. And we won the case. As I say, I defend myself a lot. I defend myself all the time now, because there is very little legal aid. That's all cut in England. I just want to concentrate a bit now on these two roles of Menwith Hill, of what they do. Originally used to monitor Soviet communications throughout the Cold War, its focus has since dramatically shifted, and today it is a vital part of the NSA's sprawling global surveillance network. I thought it's very good this morning, the way Dave and the other contributors set in context what we're actually up against. And now we can sort of look at various examples around the world as to what is happening. And Menwith Hill is key to all this. For many years, journalists and peace groups, etc., have speculated about what really goes on inside Menwith Hill, while human rights groups and some politicians have campaigned for more transparency about the activities, as have CAP. That's what we do, is to try and get accountability and public scrutiny and awareness as to what happens on these bases. Yet the British government has steadfastly refused to comment, citing a long-standing policy not to discuss matters related to national security. I'm going to tell you about how we found out about missile defense offense at Menwith Hill. And it was by sheer chance, really. It happened in 1997, and it was a long time before computers. You know, you can just look online and get some very interesting information. A lot of the freedom of information comes from America. It's very open. It's very difficult more difficult in Britain, making a freedom of information request. But what we did at Menwith Hill was to, as I say, work in many different ways. One of the ways has been to monitor planning offices. Every development that comes in, whether it's a house or whatever, has to go through the planning office, and Menwith Hill had to too. And it was, I went into the office, and then it was files, public files, and found a press release. I don't think it would have got noticed, Dave, would it? Because it wasn't public knowledge. That I'll quote it. The UK government and the US government are pleased to announce that RAF Menwith Hill is to be designated the space-based infrared system. Mm. Now, Dave mentioned a little bit of that. We could have a whole session on that, but we can't. It's an important thing. And so we didn't know what it was. What we did, what CAP did, was to bring out a legal action to try and stop the building of these. It was two radios for this system. They don't work, as we heard. I mean, Ted Postel's work is brilliant. And as I came through the airport yesterday, there was something about missile defense works like clockwork, really. Well, you know, clock, you have to wind clockwork up, they run out. So this this injunction, we brought it out in the High Court. We did it ourselves until we had to get a lawyer, and we got lawyers doing it for free. And it went on for a year, and we thought it was going to just be, struck out in the High Court. And there were four defendants that we chose very carefully. The colonel of the base, it's interesting now that the colonel of the base is not a military person, it's a civilian. And it reflects the amount of technology or the sophisticated technology that there is and the changes. And she is now she's called director of Menlo's Hill, not a military man. But the first defendant was somebody called, I have to say this rather carefully, Colonel Clyde D. Hothcock. And Hothcock. Yeah. And the second defendant was the Secretary of State for Defence, somebody called Tom King. The third defendant was the RAF commander, because I didn't say that the RAF commander is meant to command the base. Absolute nonsense. It's the US who is in total control and occupation. Really? 1 minute. Okay. Well, let me just go on. The other thing that's happened at Menlo's Hill is about drones. And it was through the work of Edward Snowden, bless him. What a wonderful person. Edward Snowden produced a whole lot of files about Menlo's Hill, and a reporter called Ryan Gallagher, who writes for The Intercept, he works from England, UK, said of these, analysed these files, and he said, the files revealed for the first time how NSA has used Menlo's Hill to have, quote, a significant number of capture-kill operations across the Middle East and North Africa, fueled by powerful eavesdropping technology. I'm not stopping yet. That can target data from more than 300 million emails and phone calls a day. Over the past decade, the documents show, the NSA has pioneered groundbreaking new spying programs at Menlo's Hill to pinpoint the locations of suspected terrorists accessing the internet in remote parts of the world, armed drones. And, you know, people always think that it's Menlo's Hill has drones, the machines. Not at all. Drones won't get off the ground until they're programmed with the information where they want that, you know, they want this thing to go and to kill. I'm going to cut quite a bit of this because, I will. The disclosures about Menlo's Hill raise new questions about the extent of British complicity in US drone strikes and other so-called target killing missions, which may in some cases have violated international laws and constituted war crimes. I haven't mentioned the special relationship, did I? That is so special that in fact the American visiting forces and their agencies do what they like, whether it's legal or not. So the work goes on to open up Menlo's Hill and the other US bases in England and try and get accountability and credibility and oversight by an independent body. It has other roles, as I say, but no time to go into those. Friends, we hold hands with you all around the world and carry on this work to send the visiting US visiting forces and their agencies back to their within their borders. They're coming back, friends. It's a tall order. We're all up against very dark forces. But we're not alone, and it's heartening to be at this conference to know that there are so many others opposing the hideous and dangerous war machine. There is another way, friends, and there's much work to do.
Our next speaker is Agneta Norberg,
who was a full-time peace activist, highlighting NATO's intrusion and war exercises in the Nordic High North and Sweden in particular, pinpointing spy stations, space downloading stations, and NEAT, the huge drone training area in the north. She's chair of the Swedish Peace Council and on the board of Global Network. She organized a space conference in Stockholm in February.
Thank you very much. I'm very pleased to be here, but I expected it to be very warm. So I bought a quite new dress for the warmth in here, and I haven't been able to show it. I want to see more clothes. It was such a disappointment. I wanted to be bare leg and walk around here in Huntsville with a new dress. And it's cold in here, and I'm freezing more than ever. Well, in 2011, on January 19th, British Prime Minister David Cameron hosted the head of states of the neutral and non-aligned countries, Finland, Sweden, together with head of states from the NATO countries of Denmark, Iceland, Norway, and the Baltic states, Estonia, Latvia, and Lithuania. It was the first Nordic-Baltic summit to consolidate an alliance of common interests. The project for a Nordic military pact was taken up by former Norwegian Defense and Foreign Minister Thorvald Stoltenberg in 2009 and provides for the creation of a mini NATO for Scandinavia and the Arctic. Stoltenberg's son, Jens, was by that time the Prime Minister of Norway, member of Arbeiderpartiet. He is now the Secretary General of NATO. The Stoltenberg Report of 2009, Nordic Cooperation on Foreign and Security Policy, focused on 13 areas for closer cooperation in the Nordic region, among others, security in the high north, cybersecurity, joint cyber defense systems, joint air, maritime, and satellite surveillance, cooperating on Arctic governance. According to experts, about 25% of the world's oil and gas resources are in the Arctic shelf, besides other natural resources. In 2009, Norway shifted its operation command headquarters from Stavanger in the south to in the south of Norway to Reitan in the north, becoming the first nation to look